Hello, YouTubers. I am here with our lovely Lee Hammock for PathFinder Online. Say hello, Lee.
Hello.
So, Lee, can you tell us what it is you do for Goblin Works and PathFinder Online?
I am the lead game designer, so it is my job to make the game fun. Most of my day is spent wrestling with spreadsheets, trying to find a mathematical equation for that where the result equals fun. For folks who are on the forums and know some of the other designers, Steven, Bob, and Tork are the other members of my team. I'm their boss and try and keep all their work organized and stuff like that. So that's generally most of it. Most of my days are spent, you know, elbow deep in spreadsheets.
Oh man, yeah, and I can imagine that patch days on Thursdays are a tough day for you.
Yeah, well, the way our schedule breaks out is when a patch goes live, obviously we stress about it because stuff breaks that we didn't see coming. But that patch left our internal server 2 weeks ago. So it's usually the sort of thing that, you know, usually I'm not stressed about it by that point because it's had a week on our internal test server, a week on the external test server, and then, you know, it's going live. So theoretically, everything should be fine. That doesn't always work out that way. But, you know, it's stressful, but it's actually the days right before our things go to our internal test server that are actually the really stressful ones, because then it's when we're really trying to get all the last-minute stuff in.
Gotcha. Okay, cool. So I've got a whole bunch of questions from the community, if you're ready.
Sure.
So let's start with one of the big ones. What changes can we expect in the next quarter in-game, and when are we going to see water in the rivers and lakes?
So the big change, like the overall goal we've got for the first quarter is getting the previously called the POI system, but calling things by an acronym all the time is really a horrible idea. So it's been changed to the holding and outpost system, where it's going to replace basically the War of Towers and become a more resource-based gameplay than strictly territory control. It'll allow players to control hexes, build what we call holdings, which are things like inns or, you know, towers or manors. We won't have all the variety of that we'll eventually have failed first go, but it'll basically be some place that provides some basic services, such as a vault, some basic training, that kind of stuff. And then within each hex, there'll also be, each wilderness hex, there'll be also space for two outposts, which are things like lumber yards and quarries and all that kind of stuff. So those will produce resources that you need to upkeep your holding. And eventually you will need to upkeep your settlement. They produce a different category of resources called bulk resources that are not like the resources people have seen previously. They are heavier. They are only produced through these things. And so it's going to be, you know, a new add-on to the economy, effectively. That's sort of like the goal. And everything we're doing is kind of building up to that. So like one of the things we're working on right now is a system called the influence system, which is a resource companies will get. And then they will spend or bank on controlling territory or declaring feuds in other companies. So it's sort of like, you know, a piece we need to build to get to having holdings. And so once we get influence done, then we'll start doing it. We'll start looking at, you know, the feud system. And so we basically have all this. And the other thing we're working on right now is company banks and settlement banks. So, you know, we're basically building all these little pieces that once we get them all together, we'll build towards the holding system. The holdings and outposts probably will not actually be completely done within Q1. I mean, we planned out basically to release, I think, EE12? Mm-hmm. I guess EE12 is technically still Q1. So it'll be right at the end. But, you know, that's sort of like what we're building towards. That's the big thing. We spend approximately two-thirds of our time building that kind of stuff, and one-third of our time trying to fix stuff that's already in. So, like, rogue sneak attack working is a big thing I want to get fixed. Heavy armor working correctly, particularly people casting spells. So I mean, there are a lot, we have basically a big list of we have a list effectively of big stuff we're working on and little stuff we're working on. So every 2 weeks we basically look at the big list and say, okay, what big thing do we want to put in, and then what can we cram from the little list, like around the edges of it. So that's
gotcha.
Basically where our plan goes. But actually, since I have my computer here, I can actually go look in that file and see what stuff we have on there.
Are you allowed to do that?
Okay. Release notes. That's not what I want. pain point fixes. There we go. So some of the stuff that's on here, settlement chat channels, changing whispers so they appear in all your chat tabs. I mean, some of them are relatively small things, but I think they'd be a big quality of life. You know, stop resource nodes from showing up when you tab target people. They're trying to tab target things. Okay, that one we fixed. One of the things that's coming in the relatively near future, Thorn Guards should stop attacking you if you have, if you are doing bad things, but it's your settlement. So
that's very cool.
They will not care if you are a member of the settlement, or if you have the attacker flag, they will not care if you're a member of the settlement. So, interesting to see how that'll go over. Getting more gold sinks in for settlements, because, you know, well, gold sinks in general. Because one of the things we want to get in is having a coin cost attached to training. It probably won't kick in for like the first four levels, so new characters won't really bug. But, you know, beyond that, have like a monetary cost involved. Have a monetary cost involved in holding towers. Like every tower you hold costs you some amount of copper per day or something like that. So, you know, that holding more towers than you need is not necessarily a good idea. You know, getting sneak attack fixed. One big one that's actually coming in on EE5 is previously, until EE5, the resource ratings for all the hexes were getting refilled to full every server reset.
Yep.
So the resources were never really going away in any meaningful form. On EE5, that's getting fixed, so you'll actually start to see resources deplete, go to lower quality, eventually run out if they're, you know, sufficiently taxed. So that'll hopefully help with the economics of the game and making, you know, certain resources rare again in certain areas. Charge fixes. Obviously, we've got to get charge fixed. We've done that one. We have targeting improvements. It's a big one. It's a big category. We have a whole other document of just targeting improvements. So that's a lot of like the like top tier ones. Oh, like one of the things that we're working on right now is, you know, getting the achievement points showing up on your character sheet, which is one of those, you know, minor things, but it's super useful.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean that's I guess a decent cross section of what the stuff we're working on. I mean, there's a bunch of other stuff that you know we're working on, but that's pretty much the meat of it.
Awesome. So, going on from the points that you've made, so when are we thinking that Pathfinder is going to be released and published in its full entire effect? And how closely are you following the timeline there at Goblin Works?
Right now, we basically were when we launched GE, we had a big internal discussion about, you know, do we want to shoot for open enrollment a year or a year and a half later? And really, I think a year and a half later is a better plan, because basically, like the things that I think can really set the game apart are a lot of the settlement stuff and the settlement economy stuff, which settlements are, you know, basically the next huge system to build. And after that, I think, is a lot of the formation stuff, because then we can get into having a scale of conflict that not a lot of MMOs have.
Mm-hmm.
So we wanted to push the date back such that we could have both of those, and to make sure that we could have, for example, you know, more of the core Pathfinder classes, and make sure, you know, we've got everything tuned up as much as possible. So, I mean, we're shooting right now for 1.5 years past EE for open enrollment, and I don't think that's too far off our original plan. That would make it July-ish of 2016, which is kind of where we expect it to be. So far, we're sticking to it pretty well. Generally speaking, while Alpha... Overall, our schedule has slipped a few months, but it has slipped less than any other video game project I've been involved with.
Awesome.
So, it's one of the things like, yes, we have not hit all the dates we'd like to, but we've hit them much closer than the two other major MMOs I've spent a significant amount of time with. We've hit them better than those did.
That's good. That's good. That gives everyone a lot of confidence. So that's really cool. Okay. So in the Pathfinder roleplay universe, there's always a small band that goes out on a challenge in the world, or goes off to a dungeon to fight beasts and horrible griblies. So in PathFinder Online, finding a small band is pretty tough. How are you guys going to improve solo play experience?
Well, one of the big things we're working on right now is we're trying to... this is maybe a weird segue for answer for that topic, but we're trying to vastly improve the company search tool. Because the number one way to improve your experience in Pathfinder Online is to find a group of people to play with. And right now, company search is terrible. It is, I type in a term, and it randomly searches a large text field for that term, and it's awful. So, I mean, like, the new one we've got has, what activities do you like? Do you like PvP? Do you like PvE? Do you like crafting? What class, you know, basically you can see what classes, companies be able to say, we're looking for fighters, or we're looking for wizards, or we're looking for experts. And they'll be able to say, we play in this time zone. Or, you know, so we're trying to give people a lot more information so they can find a company that really works with what they want to do. So instead of just randomly looking at text fields, you'll be able to say, okay, I play in the Pacific time zone, I like PvP, I'm a fighter, who's looking for me? And you should be able to find companies that are like, hey, this company is along the lines of what I want to do, I should try and join up with them. So right off the bat, we're trying to make it easier for people to, you know, get into the whole social aspect of the game. Because right now it's really hard. One of the other things we're doing, we've actually been talking a lot about this week, is improving our quest functionality. Because anyone who's played the tutorial knows our quest functionality is kind of terrible. There's no waypoints, the text box is not very big, there's no way to know a dude has a quest unless you click on him. There's no sign saying, hey, this guy will send you to go do stuff. So there's a lot of stuff that's getting fixed, a lot of which are not that hard to do. It's just finding the time to do them. And once we get the quest system tuned up a little bit, our hope is to introduce more quest-style gameplay. I mean, we're never going to be a theme park game, but, I mean, one of the things we've talked about we can do is we can have, as part of an escalation cycle, a very small chance of a dude spawning in the escalation cycle who's like, oh my god, take this thing back to Thornkeep, or take this thing to some location, and it's a random chance it happens. We really want to reward people for exploring the game and going to all the different hexes and going to all different places. So if you go out in the woods, you may find some guy who has something he needs done, or there's some story going on. So players who don't necessarily, you know, have a big group or, you know, a big social activity going on, they'd be like, hey, I just want to go explore. I'm going to go, you know, find some quests to do or something like that. Again, it's never going to be theme parky. We're never going to have, Elder Scrolls Online level of crazy quest stuff. But we can give you stuff to go do out in the woods that'll, you know, have a reward and move you forward and, you know, feel like you're accomplishing something.
Awesome. Okay, so on that note, are we going to see any raids, any dungeons like in other MMOs, any big bosses or evil enemies? And are we going to see any more lore coming into the Pathfinder Online universe?
Well, we are working on getting more bigger monsters. Like, the art team is working on a elemental skeleton that we'll be able to use for a number of different elemental models. So we are getting some bigger and bigger monsters. But where we're trying, the big problem we have right now with our monsters in general is their AI is not very good, and we don't have a capacity to make better monster boss AI without improving all of the AI. They all operate on the same framework. So until we, you know, make that framework better and more robust, any boss we make will have the same, you know, kiting issues that all of our creatures have right now. So what I'd like to do is, you know, we need to improve the basic AI, and once we get there, we'd like to go through and make the bosses who show up at the end of escalation cycles, make those guys basically like big, you know, raid level kind of, you know, the things you deal with. One of the things we also talked about doing is once we get the formation system, doing things like giants and dragons and that kind of stuff as formation level bad guys. And that, you know, it's not something you necessarily go fight by yourself. It's something, hey, we get 10 people, we form a formation, and we go fight this guy, which solves a lot of issues for us, because one of the things we want to do with formations is when the formation takes damage, it's spread amongst all the people in the formation. So damage that would one-shot one character, you know, is survivable if you're in a formation. So we're not hamstrung in the same way that a lot of the MMOs are with their boss, you know, mobs, where they can't, you know, they don't want to, you know, one-shot people all the time.
No.
So, but we have talked about, you know, we realize we've been doing a lot of concentration lately on PvP content and that, and you know, with the holdings and the outposts and all that kind of stuff. So we are looking at trying to put a little more resources and time into doing some more PvE type stuff, particularly stuff that we can include, like the quest stuff is where we can put a lot of the lore stuff in. I mean, we've been working with Paizo and getting like all the little document fragments and all that kind of stuff, trying to get little snippets in where we can. But we really want to get into having like, okay, these, here's, you know, you can talk to this guy who actually is a member of the Pathfinder Society, and he has things to say. Right now, we don't really have a good way to have a conversation with an NPC. I mean, if they give you a quest, they have a thing that pops up. But other than that, you can't talk to people. So, having more of a means to do that, having better book text so you could actually, when you read something, it's just not the item description. It actually, you know, we love to have something where you actually look, actually have like a book like UI that opens up. So, I mean, we've got a lot of plans more long term, but I mean, the short term stuff we're really looking at is trying to get the quest system improved and, start implementing that kind of stuff. That's one of the reasons we have the Badlands hexes in game, is in addition to making the territory control game more balanced, is have hexes that we can't, that we can put quest content in, so you don't have to go into someone's territory to do the quests. All the quests will either A, be completely randomly spawned, or B, take place in a hex that a settlement cannot control. Mm-hmm. So hopefully it will reduce the feeling of, hey, I'd like to do this quest, but such and such settlement controls that territory right now, and I can't get to it or something. So a lot of the quests will be in NPC hexes, or they'll be in Badlands hexes, or they'll be in monster hexes, which are theoretically neutral territory, but yeah, we'll see how it goes.
Awesome. Okay, so just going off of that, and talking about NPCs and hexes and all that kind of thing, one of the questions that we've had is that, is there going to be any revamp changes to the world? Because at the moment, every hex kind of seems the same, and when are we likely to see that?
Well, with the most recent update, a bunch of rocks got added to the world, which is not necessarily a big thing, but we're basically working on making small incremental changes, like, you know, adding rocks. One of the big things Mike wants to do, if you notice, like, all the trees in the game are the same 5 trees. Mm-hmm. And we'd like to get in and actually have different trees for different terrain types and different regions of the game, stuff like that. That requires work with the algorithm that basically places trees in the world. So it requires, you know, programmer time, stuff like that. And, I mean, the first stage of trying to make the game look more different is going to be fixing the grass. Because the grass looks kind of terrible. But, from there, we want to try and make the trees look different and make the terrain look more different, make the mountains look less like, you know, giant piles of melting ice cream. So they look, you know, Mike's description of it was they look like chocolate melting ice cream sometimes. So
with a Golgotha on the top at the moment.
So that's really what I think we're looking at trying to do, is more procedural changes that change the way the whole world is populated, because our world is enormous and we just don't have the time to go in and hand sculpt the game. Mm-hmm. When I worked on Elder Scrolls Online, that's what they did, and that's because they had, you know, they would literally have for one hex of our space, one of their world designers would probably spend 2 to 3 weeks just doing one hex. And at that rate of speed, you know, there's no way we could ever support that.
No.
Because it would be years before, you know, the game would get done. So, I mean, we're trying to look at sort of big picture procedural changes, you know, fixing the trees, making the rocks a little better, making the terrain texture better, fixing the grass, you know, that kind of stuff. That's sort of a big picture thing. I mean, the game will never have the uniqueness of a handmade game, but a handmade terrain, but we do have the advantage of size.
Yeah, it is huge. Even in the early access map, that is enormous. Yep. So the finished map is just going to be astronomically big.
The finished map is huge. It is, because it is, the map that we have is 811 hexes, and the finished map is like 2,700. So it's, yeah, it is enormous.
Gotcha. Okay, cool. So talking about hexes and everything else, and moving on from that, you guys are using the Unity game engine. So to kind of help the players and customers understand this relationship better, how much reliance is there on that organization to provide the tech required for Pathfinder? And do you have a commercial partnership agreement for collaboration with Unity?
Well, Unity is, we actually don't have that much interaction with them at this point, because most of what we're doing, we don't really need much from them. Mm-hmm. We have more interaction with, like, for example, we use Granny as our animation engine. We have more interaction with Granny, We have a program called Grome, which does all of our terrain, all of procedural terrain stuff. Mm-hmm. We have a bunch of interaction with them. Unity, we actually haven't had that much interaction with.
Okay.
Because it's, I mean, their platform is pretty stable and, you know, pretty standard at this point. So we haven't had much cause to ask them questions about stuff. I mean, usually, you know, when you license an engine or stuff like that, you have questions and back and forth on how to do stuff. But at this stage in the game, I mean, earlier in the process, we had more questions for them. But at this stage in the game, we pretty much know what we're doing. Mm-hmm. And we've modified a bunch of systems sufficiently where, you know, they couldn't necessarily help us. So, but Grome and Granny and some of the other programs we're using, we tend to have a lot more interactions with the licensee. That said, Unity is a really cool system. I really like using it. If I were to, you know, make another game, I would be, you know, strongly tempted to use it. It is kind of funny in that, you know, we've built an MMO out of it, which it was not at all designed to do. So it's been a bit of a challenge to make all these, you know, different pieces talk to each other. Because, you know, unlike a lot of, you know, unlike something like Big World or Hero Engine, there's no server back end. We had to build all that ourselves, and the whole, you know, transfer process between hexes and all that kind of stuff. So it has been a lot of work getting this all running.
Awesome. Okay, cool. So, couple of things about the game itself. So it's inspiring to see you guys attempting to bring RPG into the MMO market, so proper tabletop role-playing games where people read the books and character sheets and all that kind of stuff. That's very rare in an MMO. So is it fair to say that a balance kind of needs to be struck between a traditional MMO player, or what they are all used to, and an RPG player?
Yeah, that's a big point of concern with us, because we effectively have two target markets. We have the traditional tabletop player, and we have the online PvP player. And they're both can be attracted to aspects of our game, but they have play styles that don't necessarily mesh well. So it's basically the problem of trying to make enough PvP that the PvP players feel like they're getting their just desserts, and the make sure the PvE players don't feel abused. And one of the things we've been working on, one of the big things we've been working on is trying to introduce more mechanics, which will be coming out in the next few weeks, such as the feud system, where companies can declare feuds against each other and be PvP active, and particularly the faction system. We'd like to provide it where if a PvP player wants to attack another player, they can always find someone who is at least somewhat interested in being attacked. Mm-hmm. They can always say, okay, someone in an enemy faction has signed up. You know, if someone is an enemy faction, on some level they've said, I'm cool with PvP. Or, you know, my company's going to declare a feud on this other company, so they have a warning that we're coming for them. So only when you're really bored do you resort to, hey, I'm going to jump that guy. Because, you know, hey, I'm going to jump that guy is sort of like, it's like, I don't know, I'm trying to think of a good term that's not pejorative. It's like the roughest form of PvP. It is the form of PvP least, most likely to have a negative effect on the victim. And so we want to have the threat of that present in the game, because being able to walk around safe willy-nilly is less interesting than thinking, hey, I might get attacked. But at the same time, we don't want it to be something that happens all the time. So one of the things we're trying to work on is make sure the PvP player always has this feeling of, hey, I can go attack people in enemy factions, we can declare a feud, you know, all this stuff I can do that is attacking people who on some level are more interested in being attacked. Mm-hmm. So they're feeling of, hey, I want to attack that guy and lose reputation for it, when I can go attack all those other people for free, I'll attack the other people and leave the guy who has the reputation hit. So
yeah,
we basically tried to sort of strike that balance between the two. But I mean, it is really hard, because our game is, we have a small team, and our game is never going to be the theme park heavy story existence that World of Warcraft or Elder Scrolls Online or something like that is going to be. And that's sort of what a lot of tabletop players look for, is these big story experiences. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we're not going to necessarily have that, so we're trying to instead focus on the social aspect of tabletop and really concentrate on the, okay, you know, you play tabletop with other people, you really should play this game with other people. That's why we're, you know, focusing on doing the company search and that kind of stuff. And really try and build that aspect of, sure, you may not be going on these dungeons and you know, going on these, you know, huge grand prescripted adventures, but you're running around with a bunch of your friends, you know, fighting monsters and doing stuff. So that social experience is really, you know, is there, even if the big story experience isn't. And hopefully we can get them interested enough in the story experience that they'll look at the rest of the game and say, hey, this, you know, economic resource stuff, this is pretty cool. I get to make stuff. So, because a lot of PvE players, you know, they're often the people who like crafting. So, you know, we can get them in the door and say, hey, look, you can do neat stuff in this game, and you can make all this cool junk. You know, hopefully we'll be able to keep...
Sounds cool. I guess that from a tabletopper's point of view, they could even use Pathfinder Online for adventures, roll up a character, and just go questing as if it's kind of part of a gaming session, for example. What do you think?
Yeah, one of the things we want to do eventually with the company system is allow people to join multiple companies. So if you have, you know, five friends that you hang out with that you play tabletop with or whatever. I mean, I have a bunch of friends. In video games, you move all across the country all the time. Mm-hmm. So I've lived in literally both coasts multiple times since I've been in this industry. So I have friends everywhere. So a lot of times, the only time I get to see them is playing online. So we really want to empower people to say, hey, I know five people who may not be local or whatever. I have friends online. And while I have my company that is my big PvP company or my social company, my crafting company, whatever, this settlement company I'm part of, I have this other social group that on Friday nights, you know, at 9, we get together, run around, and that's effectively like our Pathfinder group. You know, we have two fighters, a wizard, a rogue, and a cleric, and we run around and beat up monsters and do escalation cycles or whatever, and that's our group, and we really want to provide sort of like the joining more than one company so people sort of have that social group pre-built for them.
Gotcha. Okay, cool. So, talking about other players, five people, for example, coming into the game, what has the growth in numbers of players looked like from month one of early enrollment to month two or even month three, aren't we, or something now? And what's the expected growth over the next 12 months? And what specific things is Goblin Works doing to help advertise the game and attract players? I mean, we've seen the free trial, we've seen the word of mouth kind of campaign, you know, that kind of stuff. Is that where you guys are heading?
Well, the problem with being a small team with a you know, for video games, very small budget, is we don't have a lot of advertising. So word of mouth and things like the buddy system are really the best route that we have. Mm-hmm. I mean, we luckily do have an existing fan base of, you know, the Pathfinder, which is tens and tens of thousands of people.
Yeah.
And we have a Kickstarter where we had close to 10,000 people already give us money. So, I mean, we've already got people who are invested in the game to some extent or another. So the best thing that we can do is get those people to say, hey, this game is cool. It may be a little rough around the edges, but the core of it is fun. And hopefully they'll pull in more people. I mean, our growth rate has been pretty much steadily upward. I mean, is it as fast as we would like? Eh, is it ever? I mean, sure, we'd love to have more people giving us money to play the game. It's had some noticeable spikes, like, for example, the last day where you could get the full month of XP, mm-hmm. the full backdated month, there was a huge spike over those few days. So, I mean, we've had spikes, stuff like that, but generally it's been a steady upward trend. We've seen some spikes from, like, the buddy invites. So, I mean, it's at this rate where, I'm not totally sure where we would be in 12 months. But
that's that kind of interview question where they say, where do you see yourself in 5 years, you know? Sorry about that one.
No, I mean, it's fine. It's basically the question of, because now we've got a lot of our serviceability has proved to be better than we expected. And because we have not had a lot of, well, we've obviously had a lot of bugs. We have not had, like, hexes coming down or major server crashes or anything like that pretty much since launch. I mean, we've had issues here and there of stuff being broken, but not like, oh, my God, the server burned down and fell into a swamp. It's generally been, you know, more discreet bugs. So, I mean, we are looking at trying to bring in some of the open enrollment people. You know, we've talked about bringing them in earlier since we can support them if they want to come in. Mm-hmm. That's a big discussion we're having. So, yeah, I mean, basically right now is like the numbers going up. We always like them to go up faster because, you know, more money lets us hire more people. I mean, okay, this is going to be a bit of a rant, but hopefully it's not going to be horribly mean. So, you know, I sometimes see folks in the forums who are saying, you know, oh my God, the game is too broken. You know, I will tell my friends not to play. Mm-hmm. Which, okay, some extent, I can understand what you're saying. But the best way to get the game not broken is to get more people playing it. I mean, the best way to get the game running better is to make it. Right now, we have a team of 20 people. Mm-hmm. Of that team, 4 people are programmers. And if we could hire 1 programmer, that would increase the number of bugs and new features that get in by 25%.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a huge increase in the amount of stuff proportionally that would come into the game. So, I mean, the best way to get bugs fixed in the game is, and to get more features and stuff like that is to get more people playing the game.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we operate very lean. We are, you know, like I said, small team with limited resources, but, you know, the more people we can get into the game, the better everything gets.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
So hopefully, did I answer your question?
You did. Yes. Yes, you did.
I wander around questions a lot and talk a lot. So I'm not. I'm always at the end of a question. I'm always like, did I answer that question? I talked for like 5 minutes. So I'm betting I hit it somewhere in there somewhere.
So, and one last question about the game itself. So, when are we going to see company tags, character kind of tags? You know, that kind of stuff. So
like
not,
on the above, like, yeah. So you see what company someone's in.
Exactly.
So the big thing that we want to do. The system we want to get in for that is what we've called the secondary targeting window,
mm-hmm.
Where we're probably going to show your settlement underneath your name, but we also want to have like a window at the top of the screen. Right now where it says like early enrollment,
mm-hmm.
my hands are going right off the screen. I realized I was putting over my head, and I realized all you see is my elbows.
That's okay. We get the idea.
At the top of the screen where it says early enrollment, we basically want to have a window there that says company, faction, like stuff that we want to keep the stuff on the character that is the stuff you need second to second in combat.
Mm-hmm.
Like if the character is actively hostile to you, hey, that, you know, that should be on there. Or, you know, if the character is, you know, what their hit points are, stuff like that. But stuff that's useful, like what company they're in, or what faction they're in. Unless they're actively hostile to you, you don't need that every second. And the actively hostile will be in their name will be read.
Mm-hmm.
But everything else we want to put sort of like at the top, so we have all the vital combat information is on the character, but the stuff that, you know, may be good to know will be sort of like at the top with, you know, company settlement, or a company faction, more granular reputation information. I mean, right now we only show you if you have super high or super low reputation.
Mm-hmm.
More granular reputation of, you know, showing that sort of thing. So you basically target someone and say, oh, well, they're not hostile to me. What else do I know about them? And then you could kind of look at it as your leisure. But, you know, if you target them and they're red, it's like, oh, crap! You know, that's all. If I target someone and they're red, that should be what I'm worried about right now.
Yeah, yeah, that's fair. Entirely fair. Cool. Okay. So, notice boards. Originally, there were going to be notice boards in NPC and player cities where a player could put bounties on individuals. What's happened to that?
We still want to do that. That is a bigger system. Oh, well, okay. We've refined the bounty system. Well, let me think. I mean, the bounty system has evolved such in that we've added some components and changed some things around. But we definitely want to have a system. It may not actually happen at a notice board.
Mm-hmm.
It may, don't know. What we'd like to have happen is when you die, you basically have a list of the people who killed you, and you can say, you know, if somebody kills these people, they get X amount of money as a reward, and these are the people who, and have a system for saying these are the people who are allowed to claim that reward. So, you know, for example, you can say only people in my company or only people in my settlement are allowed to claim this reward, so they don't have their friend kill them, and, you know, they don't take all their stuff off, have their friend kill them, their friend gets the money, they put their stuff back on. We don't want to have that happen. So it's definitely something we want to do. It's a complex system,
mm-hmm.
so I would not expect to see it for at least, maybe it'll come around about the same time settlements, the full settlement system,
mm-hmm.
but I would say is less important. The system I would actually really like to see if we get going, because I think it would actually be simpler in some ways, is the death curse system, where if someone kills you, you can click on the shrine where you rez to basically say, you know, curse that dude. And you could expend, it'll cost some amount of money or reputation or something, mm-hmm. but that person will lose all of, when we get to the threading system where you keep items with you when you die, as opposed to the system we have now where everything equipped goes with you. Basically, you'll death curse someone such that when they are killed, all their equipment is lootable.
Gotcha. Okay, cool.
you have, and again, it'd have to have some type of requirement of, you know, only, you know, people in my settlement or my company or whatever can take advantage of it. But that's, and these would only be on reputation loss kills. I mean, if you kill somebody in a war, you know, they can't death curse you or whatever. But if you basically, if you kill someone and he has to take a reputation loss, they could put a bounty on you or death curse you or whatever.
Cool. Okay, awesome. So, last thing, last question. We did royal, okay, didn't we? So, can you tell us about the CrowdForge enrollment options and what makes them kind of so special and worthwhile? And also, can you give us a sneak peek into any special deals that are coming up?
I don't know about special deals. That's a Ryan question.
Okay.
I unfortunately don't. I freely admit I'm not up on the business side of things as I should be. But the CrowdForging options, I mean, there's been a lot of stuff we tried to do, like, for example, give people who have some of the higher options access to they had access to the alpha first and stuff like that. It's not so much a thing now, but people who go for some of the higher options get, you know, access to the test server, get a bunch of invites to the test server. The big thing that we want to try and do, which people got a sneak preview with at the end of the alpha, we gave everybody who had pledged a certain level or higher all the GM commands in the game, mm-hmm, and let them do horrible things to each other. And we're not going to do that again. But one of the things we really want to try and do is when we have, like, you know, a big event or something, invite people who are at that level to say, hey, you guys can, you know, we'll give you a special login, a special account for a limited time where when you log in, you can go play a giant. And mm-hmm, you can, you know, rampage around this area or something like this lines. Or, you know, when we have these huge level monsters and we have these events going on, those are the people we really want to try and pull in to get involved in what's going on. Just because it's fun to play a giant and smash people. But we want to do that. But also, we're still working on getting our CrowdForging voting system up. Mm-hmm. Because what we're trying to do is set up a voting system on the login screen of the game. So everyone who logs in can vote on things that, you know, we need to figure out, you know, we need information on. Because mm-hmm, one of the problems we have right now is if we were to put something up, like, on the forums or on the IdeaScale site we've been using, we only get a very small segment of the population feedback on that. We want to get, you know, more people. So, I mean, we want to get one up there relatively soon on what classes we should do next, because the art lead time on getting the armor suits for a class is months. So we need to basically, you know, get that all started soonish. If we want to have, you know, paladins, barbarians, sorcerers, and bards, you know, a year from now, we need to get started on them in the next few months to make sure all of their suits get done.
Yeah, absolutely.
So yeah, I mean, we want to get that system up and running so we can start getting more feedback. And I mean, one of this is something I mentioned before. And one of the big problems we have is making clear to all the players is the resources involved in doing things. Because, for example, building suits of armor take up the same resources as making monsters. So, you know,
wow.
Yeah, I mean, it's basically the character artist time. I mean, the monsters also, both of them require character artist time to make the actual model and concept artist time. The monsters also require animation time. So, I mean, there's an extra bit on there. But it is the sort of thing like, you know, if we do more suits of armor, we have fewer monsters. If we do more monsters, we have fewer suits of armor. So there are some trade-offs we run into like that, like, you know, and also like for animations. If we do more attacks, we have fewer new monsters because they all come from the animation budget. And, you know, if we do more, the more time we put on putting new features in game, like holdings and outposts, the less time we have to do, like, you know, quality of life bug fix stuff. So, I mean, everything's a trade-off, and making that transparent to the players for CrowdForging purposes is really hard, and it because there are times where people have great ideas for, like, hey, you should fix X system by doing this thing. I'm like, yeah, that would be awesome to do that, but that requires all these resources that we don't necessarily, that if we use them, we won't be able to do all this other stuff. Because, like, for example, like, Stephen, Bob, Pork, and I, we can do all kinds of balance changes and stuff like that in the system, but we can't do the programming changes to, you know, fix a lot of the bugs. I mean, like, the charge being broken right now. Stephen can set charge on attacks and stuff like that, but he can't fix the fact that the charge is kind of broken right now. So and they're trying to make clear for crowdforging purposes, you know, okay, we can do, you know, X, Y, or Z thing because they have comparable resource draws is something we're trying to work on, because just casting forth into the ether, what should we do next, is ultimately not very useful to us, because, you know, while we do get useful suggestions, we also get a lot of suggestions that are like comparing apples to oranges.
Yeah.
You're like, okay, you know, or just don't understand the trade-offs that it would take to do. Like, for example, if we wanted to go back and hand sculpt all the terrain in the world, we could set our environment artists to do that. It's just we would never have the buildings for settlements done. I mean, you know, because he's the guy who would go through and do that is also the guy who makes all the buildings. So, you know, do we want no new buildings for settlements, or do we want to have nice terrain? So everything is a toss-up with a team this size.
Gotcha. Okay, cool. One last question. When Ryan comes down as an NPC into the world, can he be killed?
By default, all of the game characters have god mode put on them. It can be turned off. If he turns his off, he can be killed. So, and I have actually, I've been testing escalation cycles before and stuff, and turned mine off because I needed, or I tested, the other day I was in testing resurrection shrines, and I had my god mode turned off because I needed things to kill me. So, I mean, theoretically, if you jump me during those moments, people could totally kill me, because most of the times our GM characters have starting character stats because we haven't spent any XP on them. You know, they're just teleporting around and getting people out of holes. If he turns god mode off, he's totally killable. That said, most of the people at the company have an actual no cheat code character that's in the game somewhere. I mean, we basically have a blanket policy of, if you ask us, we'll say yeah. We try to be as transparent as possible. We have very strict rules over what these characters can do. I mean, they have no cheat code abilities. They're just normal characters. So, I have one that's running around like in the north part of the map within the Highland Alliance area. You know, I've been using it for doing resource measurements, basically, like what I get out of nodes and stuff like that firsthand. But Lisa's got a character who runs around the south of the map. So I mean, most of the people in the company have a no cheat character that you could, you know, hunt us down and kill us, because generally speaking, you know, our characters probably are. I have the problem of, I'm one of those guys who, you know, I got my month of backdated XP and went, I will buy every skill. So he has like everything. He sucks at all of it. So. Yeah, when you spend as many XP points as I have at this point with all the testing I've done, yeah, I just have a really hard time concentrating on one thing, because my brain is always like, I can always make more. Then I run out and I'm like, crap, I can't make more.
Awesome. It's been an absolute pleasure to talk to you, Lee. Thank you very much, and hopefully we'll talk again. So if you enjoyed that interview with Lee Hammock, please like it. Subscribe to my channel, and there's going to be a lot more where that came from.